Perfect. How are you doing?
So welcome, everybody. Welcome to the show, Your Quality of Life, Healthier Alternatives. And today I'm very excited to speak to a young lady named Adina Lichtman. She is an amazing young lady from New York who during her time at university founded a charity with an unusual name. Knock, knock, give a sock. Welcome to the show, Adina.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to be here. I also think it's really special that we connected through LinkedIn. You know, I think it's so unique how people are connecting today.
You never know who you meet. And when you started that charity, it was 2015.
Yes.
What inspired you to found a charity? And of all the possible charities, one that collects socks.
Yeah, so it's a great question. I was in college not too long ago, a couple of years ago, and I was in my sophomore year and I was giving out sandwiches to some of my neighbors on the street. And one guy said to me, "Ma'am, it's so nice you're giving out sandwiches, but one thing we could really use are a pair of socks." So I went and I opened my drawer and I saw I had pink socks and polka dotted socks, and they weren't going to fit my new friend Diego. So I decided to go and knock on every door on my floor in college in my dorm. And in 15 minutes, I got over 40 pairs. Fast forward to my senior year of college, we had spread to over 20 college campuses that collected over 50,000 pairs of socks. And I joke that I kind of became a sock celebrity on campus. You know, people were even calling me a social entrepreneur, and I didn't even know how to spell the word entrepreneur. But you know what was very interesting? What I realized was that so many of my friends who were collecting socks actually didn't know so much about homelessness. And, you know, as I mentioned before, I kind of went on and I started, I started speaking in different college campuses, in different synagogues, in different schools, in different churches. And I encourage everyone listening today to ask themselves the two questions I'm about to ask you. And the first question I would ask is, who here has ever given money, food, or clothing to someone in need? And almost everyone would raise their hand. But then I would ask a second question. I would say, who here can tell me the name of one person experiencing homelessness? Almost no one could raise their hand. And I was on this liberal college campus at NYU. And, you know, people are so careful about the way they speak. They're so politically correct. They're so careful. But when it came to homelessness, they would say, isn't everyone who's homeless choosing to be homeless, right? These massive stereotypes. Or aren't most people who are homeless doing drugs or, you know, drinking, you know? Or other people would say, come on, don't they all have mental illness? And actually, we know, you know, especially on college campus, we don't say mental illness, right? We talk about mental health, mental well-being, mental wellness, right? And we actually don't use the word mental illness on college campus very often. It's kind of all of these things were being lumped together when we would talk about homelessness. I remember even seeing a sign one night on my college campus, I'm on the subway, that said, come volunteer with us. It was a huge organization. It said, come volunteer with us, feed the homeless. And I remember thinking, imagine if I saw a sign that said, come feed the Jews, right? Because I'm a Jewish person. Or if I saw a sign that said, feed the blacks, right? We'd be like, what? So infantilizing, right? You feed animals, you feed children who can't feed themselves, but other adults, it's not the way we speak.
It's kind of condescending, isn't it? How we treat the homelessness, it's kind of a group that gets looked down on generally. And everybody that's on the streets is an individual. Tell us a few stories. I know you talked to many of them individually. What are their stories? Why did they end up on the street?
So I'll go into that. But before I go into that, I'd actually even like to take what you're saying a step further, right? It's so condescending. On the one hand, right, the way we talk about it, the way we approach it, right? But on the other hand, there's also this like give back culture where we take pictures of ourselves wearing hairnets and gloves and being at the soup kitchen and serving food, right? And we walk out of that place feeling great, you know, feeling so good about ourselves, like I did something today, I gave back, as opposed to feeling the empathy that we're supposed to feel when we actually connect with our neighbors? So really interesting question that you ask. And, you know, what are some of our neighbors' stories? So I'm going to talk, I'm going to be a little bit New York centric right now, as someone who lives in New York. But what's so interesting is what most people don't know about homelessness is that actually street homelessness is only 5% of homelessness in New York City, which means 95% are living in shelters. And out of that 60,000 people who are homeless, 25,000 are children. And these are the names and the faces and the stories that get lost when it comes to learning about homelessness. I have one close friend of mine who was a bank teller at Wells Fargo, and then he developed Crohn's. So he had to take a lot of sick days. He took too many sick days to be able to, you know, get the same pay. So he ended up moving into a shelter, but he was still going to work every day. And then one of his clients saw him leaving the shelter and went and told the bank manager, "I am not comfortable with that man handling my money anymore," because she saw him leave the shelter. And then he lost his job. And he was already suffering from Crohn's, and it spiraled out. And now he's, you know, a man in his 30s who doesn't have a job, who's living in a transitional shelter, but has never been able to get back to work because of that experience. I have another friend who he was living, I might be wrong about the state, so I'm going to say a state, but it might be the wrong one. I'm pretty sure it was Virginia. And he basically was working out there as a construction worker. He was like in his 50s. It was like getting close to him retiring, but they actually had to let go of many of their employees much earlier than they wanted to. And so him and 10 other guys were let go, and he didn't have, you know, there was no savings. There was no retirement pension. He was too old to start a construction job someplace else. He didn't have the skills for other places. And he quite frankly couldn't get housing there. So he was told that New York City has a lot of resources. So he moved out to New York City, and he's been living, he's a man in his, you know, late 50s now, who's been living in a homeless shelter for the last 2 years, waiting to get services from the state to be able to get housing. These are just a few of the many stories that we hear from so many of our neighbors getting hurt on construction sites, not being able to work afterwards, to, you know, being a single mom, to being a woman who, you know, to women who I met who got out of domestic violence relationships. There are so many reasons why so many of our neighbors end up experiencing homelessness. And a lot of them, even if you have a job, right, a minimum wage job, that's not going to cover cost of living, especially here in New York City. And people say to me all the time, they're like, so why are they living in New York City? But the reason why is urban cities also have the most resources, right? If you're living in you know, some remote city, you know, some remote town, you're going to need a car to get around. There are less access to resources. There are less programs right there to help you. So it really is a catch-22 to being able to, you know, get set up. So yeah, that's so basically,
I really like that you call them neighbors, because they are really neighbors. They are people just like you and I that fell in dire circumstances.
Yeah. And they're living so close to us.
They are the addicted ones. They are the ones with that suffer from a mental illness and can't access the right help, or just don't see that they need it. They are those too. But I'm kind of appalled that so many are children.
Yeah, but you know what's even interesting about that? You know, I think many of us know people who have suffered from mental health issues. I think there are many people that we know who have suffered from drug addiction.
Of course.
Where are they coming from, right? Because if you grow up in poverty, then you're going to end up on the streets, right? Rather, if you come from a family that can help support you, then you're more likely to be able to get help. Might not solve the issue. You know, I know many people from my childhood who have grown up and, you know, ended up going from rehab to rehab, to their parents' couch, to back to rehab, but mm-hmm. they have that parents' couch. And for many homes, it's another mouth to feed on top of experiencing poverty, right? And I always say one of the leading causes of homelessness that people don't think of is loneliness, mm-hmm. lack of access to resources and networks and people. And that's where
I think that is that people get so lonely that they end up on the street and stay there for a while.
Here's an interesting statistic, which I didn't mention, but this one, once you hear it, you're like, that's horrible. And that also makes so much sense. 50% of kids who age out of the foster care system, meaning they turn 18 or 21 and they are no longer part of the foster care system. They've never been adopted. They go from home to home. 50% of those kids will end up homeless within 6 months.
Oh, wow.
Right? So, you know, in a situation like that, it's so clear. The amount of people who identify as LGBTQ who end up being kicked out of their homes, thrown out of their homes, also extremely high percentage, right? Then there are the people who lost their job, who then couldn't get back on their feet, who felt so much stress, who then leaned on drugs after, you know, they ended up facing eviction or facing homelessness. There's one friend who I know who was a chef, and his wife died really suddenly. She got sick really quickly. She died really suddenly. A few months later, he fell into quite a deep depression. He went to one dentist appointment where they gave him painkillers. He ended up becoming addicted to those painkillers. You know, it was the first time he escaped the pain after losing his best friend of 20 something years, right? So there are so many different stories and reasons. And I think it's very easy to kind of look at addiction and be like, oh, well, it's their fault, right? And the idea is like, where do we come from? You know, if you did, it's interesting when I think about
an addiction suffer just as much as anybody else, and they don't want to have that addiction, or it wouldn't be an addiction, it would be a choice, and an addiction is not a choice.
And it's not that, you know, addicts become homeless, right? It's we have addicts in every community, right?
Of course, we have addicts in the rich community
and the most poor communities, right? It's just if you're poor and you become an addict, there tends to be this mentality of, well, you're an addict, it's your fault. And it's like, we have them in every community. They're just different resources, right? And that's something that I always found fascinating.
It's easier to hush it up if you have the money to do so.
100%. So I'll move on to basically, you know,
tell us how we can help.
We became this organization that collected socks for our neighbors in need. But what I realized was, so many of my classmates actually didn't know much about homelessness. So I decided to bring 50 of my college classmates and 50 people living in local shelters to have dinner side by side. And at that dinner, college students said, Adina, I can't tell who's homeless and who's not. They're meeting moms who have three kids who couldn't afford childcare, dads who got out of prison and couldn't get jobs afterwards, people working minimum wage jobs, but that doesn't get you out of the shelter system.
No.
So all of a sudden, homelessness had a name and a face and a story to it. And it was at that moment that I wanted, you know, Knock Knock Give a Sock to be my career, but I wanted it to be about these dinners. And I didn't want to do these dinners on college campuses. I wanted to do these dinners in big corporate companies. But I was a little college graduate. You think JP Morgan's going to listen to me like, oh yeah, we want to do a dinner with your employees and people living in shelters. Oh, and we want to do it in your office. Like, are you nuts? It's such a radical idea. So the way we start, that's when our mission became humanizing homelessness one sock at a time by turning transactions into interactions. So now we engage companies in doing a sock drive in their office. We go to JP Morgan, we go to Salesforce, we go to WeWork. We get these companies to do a sock collection in their office. And after they do a sock collection, we then invite their employees and people living in local shelters to have dinner side by side in their offices. And that's how we put a name and a face and a story to homelessness. And so I would say, you know, large scale, that's what Knock Knock Give a Sock does. We engage companies in doing a sock drive. We then hire our neighbors to actually pick up and drop off those socks. And then we do these meet your neighbor lunches and dinners with these different corporate companies. And the one thing I'd like to add is, you know, you mentioned it's so nice how you call them your neighbors. What's interesting is when we kind of set up these dinners, no one's allowed to serve somebody else. And, you know, we have these icebreaker questions on the table and everyone sort of connects. And I kind of set the framework of, hey, we're a community coming together. We're neighbors, blah, blah, blah. I tell our story. And what's fascinating is at no point do I tell the employees oh, and you should refer to people who are homeless as your neighbors. Not once. But what happens is at the end of the night, I'll have people who work at the company being like, listen, I was talking to my one neighbor and he was telling me this story. I was talking to my neighbor and we're actually going to meet, right? But it naturally changes language, and how easy, I notice how easy it is for us to change language naturally. And it's been a very cool experience.
That is such a cool thing. And I really would like to help you spread the word. And say somebody listens to this video or watch that podcast, and they would like to do something similar, or start a chapter of the Knock Knock Give a Sock Society in their area. What can they do? How they can contact you?
I would love that. I'll say two things. One, if you have new socks to donate, you can always donate them directly to us. You can go on our website, www.kkgs.org, or you can DM us on Instagram, where it's just straight Knock Knock Give a Sock, or you can email me, Adina, A-D-I-N-A, at kkgs.org, and you can send socks to us. But what we like to do best is engage communities. So whether you're a part of a religious community, locally based community, corporate community, your office, whatever it is, we love to engage communities in doing sock drives and meet your neighbor events. So I would encourage you to go on our website and sign up your community to get involved.
I love that. Thank you so much, Adina, for speaking to homelessness, promoting that homelessness is really not something people choose, but it's something people end up with and they can get back out of if exactly. They get the right support, and maybe minimum wage is not a good way to employ people. It's safe, but it's not enough in Canada. The same thing in minimum wage, you can't afford rent.
Minimum wage, or
you have to have two people
hard
working.
For people post-incarceration after being imprisoned to get jobs. That's also really difficult.
People that are older and being let go, they sometimes meet, you're too old to do that kind of work, or they get an illness and can't do it. And there's no network for disability sometimes. So that is another case. So I'm happy to have been the opportunity to talk to you, and I wish you all the best. And underneath that video will be your name, of course, and the website to go to. And if you have the resources to help, please do so. It's a good cause.
Thank you so much. This was so wonderful. Thank you.
Thanks, and give a sock.